Hello, everyone. I'm Tim Sorna. I work on the browser extension known as MetaMask. In fact, you've actually seen our product in action through the other speakers. If you've seen sort of like the box in the Chrome extension, that's us. We built that. And so we have about 240,000 users using us right now, up from 15,000 in April. So we've sort of seen this wave of new users, and we're at the forefront of this new sort of decentralized app ecosystem on the web. And so alongside my Etherwallet, we have been on the front lines, and we've seen sort of what's actually happening with our users. And so this presentation today is just meant to be a very quick overview of what we've learned and observed over this past year. What has the DAO ecosystem evolved into, and what can we learn from it? I apologize, these are some old slides, but I'll work with them. So if we go back to the Ethereum white paper, it describes sort of these three types of DApps: financial, semi-financial, and non-financial, and gives a ton of use cases, like example use cases for them. And so if we look at the sort of decentralized application marketplace right now, almost all of them are being simultaneously working, and that's great. But this presentation is going to focus really on those end-user applications that people can access in a browser. So nothing about infrastructure, nothing about protocol, something about things that people can see right on your browser. What are users, like just normal users, using today? And we at MetaMask have had the privilege of just sort of observing that behavior up close. So we'll start with the first observation. This year has been a year of sales. ICOs, token sales have defined our space, at least in the public platform. Just to give an example, when I looked at sort of the data from Harper 18th, and we looked at the top crypto assets at the time, only 13 of the top 100 crypto assets at the time were built on Ethereum using ERC-20 token model at about a 300 million market cap. Now we jump forward to today. It's at approximately 200 billion. We've seen that number a million times already today. I'll throw it again. And now, instead of 13, it's now 90 of the top 100 crypto assets are being built on Ethereum. And so we've seen this rapid growth. It's been a wild west of funding. We've seen that there's, just as Simon King mentioned, there have been tons of unfortunate funding measures and government are taking action against it. But we're learning from that. We're definitely learning from that. And we're testing sort of the limits and norms of what we should be doing in terms of handling with these things. I really like to thank Vitalik for his paper on how we can move forward in sort of making these different models around the world. Because sort of the key thing that's been sort of testing us is capitalizing on FOMO. If there's anything that we've seen that really defines sort of as a bad sale, it was FOMO, like racing to buy. And so early this year, we saw the effects of that firsthand. Basically, a token sale would happen, and the network would amazingly follow up all of these transactions because of sort of badly written contract code. So transactions that are supposed to take 6 to 12 seconds are now taking hours upon hours to complete. And this is an unacceptable usability issue in our space. And thankfully, it seems to have been learning from our mistakes, but it's been a hard process to sort of navigate. 2017, both MetaMask and my Etherwallet also have seen an application for managing your Ethereum keys. We've both been having the same issue, dealing with tokens. It's sort of hard for us to see anything else in the bushes besides those, but it's something we have to acknowledge. But we personally hope that if 2017 was the year of sales, that for 2018, now that all the capital has been raised, we will start to see actual applications being made up. So the key takeaway here is that with sales, as a community, we're starting to sort of become smart as to how do we inform the public about these sites. A lot of the people who are interested in doing these sales, a large group of them are beginning. They don't know much about blockchain, they don't know much about maybe what they're investing. And they'll read this white paper that was bought on Fiverr for like $100. And like binds the idea of that really sort of knowing what distinguishes a good sale from a bad one. And so I think we at MetaMask are recognizing that the community is becoming smart to that. And hopefully next year, along with sort of the regulations that the organization to impose, the community will also start to self-regulate itself into finding out what exactly are those best practices for conducting a good sale. Just to sort of give an example of sort of the growth this time. This is the bottom of the top 100 in February of what crypto assets look like on CoinMarketCap. And you can see sort of like at the bottom, it's a market cap of volume of 1 million. This is from a few days ago. You can see there's a remarkable growth. So there's a ton of potential in place when we go around already in this space. Observation and experience. Decentralized apps, it's very clear that financially native products are what's dominating the market and what's dominating what was dominating in sort of the transactions. So these are some stats from one day of MetaMask usage. As you can see at the very left, you can see that EtherDelta is one of our most popular decentralized applications. And so you can see some other applications like Registrar and Ethereal, other stuff, but you can see it's just completely drowned out by a lot of these financially driven applications. Observation is that we've also seen 2017 grow into sort of a developer's paradigm. Other than EtherDelta and OSS Dex and those financial applications, we've actually been seeing apps that are not really specifically described in the white paper, and sometimes can be sort of esoteric. For example, we have applications like Hello Sugoi that are used for ticketing, Libra, which is a decentralized what's been really hitting the news recently is CryptoKitties, basically reading your cats on the blockchain. That's been an interesting one. Bitcoin is an app where you can have an open source project post bounties and their issues, and eventually it should be able to sort of inform when the issue has been resolved and not air the cash So, you have these wide range of apps, both practical and a little silly, helping the space. But it goes to show, the takeaway is that there's been this huge creativity that's been blossoming in the space that really transcends sort of what we initially envisioned about to do. And so, as it says up there, there are approximately 854 decentralized applications listed on the website State of the Maps. And there's even more technology coming that will mean even more apps to arise. So even though Spotlight has been on finance, I thoroughly believe that there has been a quiet breeding ground for sort of delving into what we don't even know right now are the possibilities of blockchain. Only the surface. You can go a lot deeper. I think one of the things that really makes me happy is that documentation has gotten a lot better over the past few months. A lot more tutorials, more in-depth documentation on the tools that we use, better tools in general. Developers are now feeling that they're empowered to really enter this space is relatively young compared to the rest of sort of the other technologies that it's built on. And so yeah, the developer, I use that because it equalizes the technology. So we've seen a lot of speakers today who have very impressive credentials and sort of where they come from in their background. things. But a lot of the applications that I described here, they're being built by people who are not necessarily veterans in the space, not necessarily people who have been working in software development for many decades. And so, what I believe blockchain has enabled us to do is to sort of allow a new gateway for people who felt that they couldn't enter in some new tech before, and really just jump right in. And so I find that if we continue to foster that documentation, I think Simon Kim and his point on building community is a really important point, because it is ultimately the developers that will help us grow the ecosystem. The capital is there, there have to be developers. Developers who are capitalized on that. And so another observation, and I believe this is the sort of final one, is we've been going through at MetaMask, we've been observing sort of the great usability experiment. And what I mean by this is that although we are working very hard on technological improvements to the blockchain, we still have sort of this gaping issue of solving end user usability. I think one of the things I want to point out for the slide is the dropping rise of phishing. So, since this technology is very new and there are a lot of newcomers to this space, a lot of those users do not give their private keys the same kind of weight that they should be giving, that they would give to, say, a credit card number, bank account number, identification number. Right? A private key is something that some people really give out willingly. And I think that this is a major usability problem we haven't been able to sort of approach for users. The educating of this is really important data. You can't just like throw this to the wind. And so fishers have been able to capitalize on this very well. I think one infamous example is that there was a token sale going on. I won't name the specific one, but they didn't post their contract code for their contract address ahead of time. And so what happened was that there was a group of malicious hackers who replaced the address on the website without the token developers knowing. And so what happened was that there were tons of these people just submitting user using this address that should have been posted before. And so there are just a ton of things that we have to develop as standards and sort of norms in the developer community here to sort of go forward in this very vulnerable part of the blockchain ecosystem. No matter how cryptographically secure we make our application, if we cannot secure our content as well, what use is it to have some units that's secure? And so these are sort of the haunting issues that continue to be debated, we continue to sort of be argued upon. Yes, is kind of this one. Addresses, I believe, is solved with ENS, but unfortunately, the adoption hasn't been as quick as I would hope. But hopefully, adoption will follow. Gas is another issue that's sort of been a huge roadblock in terms of usability. It's a concept that's really confusing to explain to users. And it may not necessarily be decisions either to block it away, or block it away as an option, or say even pay for it. The discussions are ongoing, but it's really hard to sort of argue the pros and cons of each. I mentioned again the long wait times, the when transactions ranging from 6 seconds to 8 hours. Interestingly enough, it's from our perspective at MetaMask, it's been very interesting to tell users that once they submit a transaction to the network, there is no way of reverting it, right? It's blockchain, right? Once it's written in, it's hard to sort of write out unless 51% of that, right, or a hard fork. And so explaining to these users who are very used to traditional finance systems that are centralized, who have the power to sort of revert these transactions and to use leverage in order to pressure the funds to come back to the user. There's nothing of that sort here. Unless we implement some sort of EIP, it's like once you submit your transaction, it's gone. And so many users have just sort of typically sent the transaction 2 times, or send a transaction that they didn't mean to, and they come to us and ask, like, where's my Ether, where are my tokens? And all we can tell them is that, sorry, we're out of luck. And so this is another sort of discipline point that we really need to discuss as a community. How do we sort of approach these new paradigms that aren't, these new design challenges that aren't present in traditional financial institutions? I think I'll end this slide by discussing currently the current cost of gas. By sending a basic transaction at 1 gigawatt, so not even sort of the average gas price, but like the minimum gas price to sort of probabilistically get mined, multiplied by sort of the current gas amount for a simple cent transaction is 1 cent per transaction. For a lot of these applications that I've described, like, such as using Leroy for Twitter, like, having to pay a cent for every tweet you post is just sort of unsustainable. I would normally have a slide here sort of describing my main takeaways. So I'd just like to describe a few main points for me on this. One, Vinay actually sort of put this specifically in that we need to come together as a community and to set defining the standards of how we address the design issues. Because this is sort of like the big barrier that's, it's not just us developing good design standards, but uniform standards that are accepted throughout the community. If our users do not know how to approach these sort of blockchain principles and they're different from app to app, it just sort of hurts us when we try to integrate with one another. So hopefully we can do that next year in 2018. As I said, we should lend more weight on the permanence of transactions, telling users, hey, once you submit this, this is going to happen, this is most likely going to happen, right? And so really emphasizing how dangerous it can be to submit a transaction, we need to resolve that. We need to continue streamlining and the onboarding process. Right now, although we have made several strides in making it very easy for people to acquire Ether and tokens, it's still sort of hard for first-time users to get set up. There's still room for improvement. It's not as smooth as other financial application departments. We can continue to streamline that, but the user adoption will go way up. Anti-phishing is an important layer of security. So with my EtherBot, there are so many, they go through so many phishing attempts per day that it's almost overwhelming. MetaMask has been able to sort of avoid this so far by being a browser extension, but as soon as we sort of move to this new model called MetaMaskera, it will become a big issue for us too. And so learning from sort of traditional web development and seeing how they tackle anti-phishing will be important. And then finally, I'd like to say that the future of DApps is bright, independent of how the price will be developing from now on. Right now it's on an uptrend, but no matter where the price goes, the technology is there to be utilized. And again, we barely scratched that surface. And so I am very optimistic that next year we will see a lot more progress in sort of seeing these smaller decentralized applications come into light and some more diverse community. Thank you.